I'm Suchitra, and he's Aman, and we represent the Finance and Investment Club of IIM Shillong. We are here with Mr. Dhirendra Kumar, and he's the founder and chief executive of Value Research. A leader in its domain, Value Research covers everything and anything when it comes to investment avenues, be it mutual funds, stocks, and or fixed investment options. So, Mr. Dhirendra, we would like to have some, a very casual conversation about the current trends in the Indian economy. So my first question would be, what are your views on the trade war that's been going on, and how can it impact India?
It can impact India because you know, US is our biggest trade partner, and we are a big exporter of our services there. And service export is very much in the spotlight. That is the start of the discussion. That was the start of the discussion. But at the same time, I don't think of it as a permanent thing. Because global trade is a way the world runs now, and it is irreversible. So there could be questioning, there could be public political questioning, there could be tweaking, there could be tariff changes, there could be tariff levy, there could be restrictions, there could be clampdown. But I don't think the whole world needs each other, and the whole world needs each other in a manner that you are good at something, so you do that. I am good at something, you do that. And that may not necessarily balance. That may not necessarily translate into a trade balance. But then that is how the world is configured. You have to enhance your competitiveness. And also we have to wait for the next regime. Are the changes being done in the US of a permanent kind? They are tweaking on the tariffs. It hurts us, and it can hurt us further. It can hurt some other geographies even more. But I don't see that as something which will permanently damage the fabric of the trade globally. But in the short run, it definitely hurts.
So adding on to that question, that around sanctions that have been recently imposed, how does that impact India?
I would like to skip this question. Sure. I'm not very knowledgeable about it, so I would like to.
Sure.
In terms of understanding the implication of the clampdown.
Okay. So talking about the macroeconomic picture. As we see, the rupee has been depreciating in this year for about 10 to 12%, and we have a rising CAD. So how do you see the macroeconomic picture of a country like India being hampered or being impacted by the depreciating rupee?
You don't have a choice. If oil prices goes up, and if we have our biggest import bill, which is oil prices, then it is bound to happen. But the saving grace is that this time round, we are not importing gold like mad. As in 2008, when we hit another such scale. That's one. But it is bad for us. But still, if you look at it in the global context, we are still in the bright spot in the world. We are the only economy which is growing. This cannot go on like this forever. We have to, and our, the companies have to regain their earnings momentum. Companies are not able to grow their earnings. They are always facing some headwind or the other. There is a squeeze on credit. There is public sector banks are struggling. We have this this current account deficit leading to rupee depreciation, where our exports might benefit, but imports are getting expensive. So our capital goods segment, which is heavily dependent on that, will suffer. So we will have multiple things happening. It's hard to predict, but I would say that many of these things are ponderables, and they are beyond control. You really can't do anything about it. The whole investment framework works on the manageability, the ponderables, the things which is things on which you have a greater control. Can you do something in a manner that will definitely help this company? Can the government do something which will definitely help the sector? I think we are doing a lot of those things. In a economy like ours, where everybody is struggling, the banking sector is not able to provide credit. The government has embarked on an infrastructure plan which is driving the economy so substantially, creating employment opportunity. We have seen the record growth in cement production and steel production while we say that the economy is struggling. So we still have one arm of the government driving the growth. And once it gets broad-based, I don't know how long it will take, but it should get broad-based at some point. I don't have a roadmap when it will get reversed. But most economies are cyclical. We're still the bright spot.
So during the discussion, during the panel discussion, there was one topic that came up, economic prosperity. So it was mentioned that some states have more economic prosperity than others. So, you know, leaving the rural India, if we just talk about the urban India, the user penetration, you know, of the towards the stock market is still less. It's just about 5%. So, what can we do, you know, to increase that kind of reach towards urban people also?
Two, three things needed. One is that people simply should have more surplus to invest, because you can't invest till you have savings, and you have savings which comes only after you have spent the money for consumption. So, you know, there are different ways of doing it. I don't think you can actually make savers out of impoverished people.
Mm-hmm.
People need to earn, and they should need to earn little more than they spend.
Mm-hmm.
That's one. Then comes, you know, an inflation control. Managing the inflation will play a key role. If the inflation goes out of hand, we will have fewer savers. More people will, you know, the people who are likely to be saving, they will not save. More money will be spent on essential consumption. That's one. Then comes, you know, simplifying things. Today, the understanding, we talked about in the session that, you know, there are enough product and people can do it. Things are complex. If we simplify it, I think it will become more usable. Then, which means that if somebody has to choose from one of the five funds for his needs, money for a few days, money for a year or two,
mm-hmm.
and if he has limited choice, and simplification of the design,
right.
That will help people a lot. Because today, the personal finance arena, where individual investors exercise a choice of making whether to invest or buy a product, is very complex, very less understood. You don't come across a five-line statement that if you buy this, you will get this, and you will not get this.
Mm-hmm.
It is in legalities of, you know, disclaimers and this and that, and finally after reading all that, you may not be able to figure out what it stands for. There is a 20-page policy document which you get after you buy insurance, which is all printed in fine print. Simplification. Then comes, you know, providing some tax incentive to the lowest strata of saver.
Mm-hmm.
The smallest saver, if he can be incentivized to save, that will actually, you know, and if the small savings are also getting digitized, if people can buy their national savings certificate or post office recurring deposit online, that will be a big turning point in terms of learning.
Right.
People need to get used to it.
Right. So as you mentioned the problem and the issue with the public sector banks. So what are your views about the privatization and the liberalization of the PSPs?
Privatization and disinvestment are two things. It should be privatized. Then you have a real change. If you disinvest, there is no real change. We know that it is taxpayers' money.
Right.
And government in its hurry is trying to disinvest, to realize some money to bridge the budget deficit that they have. Having revenue target for the government is important, but the real problem that this country needs to solve is that public sector is a real, you know, drain of public resources. The real charm of the public sector is that they should become productive. They should have enhanced productivity. They should provide greater employment opportunity. That should be the government's goal. This is exactly what happened when last time disinvestment happened. For example, government sold ITDC hotels, not ITDC the company.
Mm-hmm.
They sold the properties of ITDC to different buyers,
right.
On an individual bidding basis.
Mm-hmm.
So it was all a done deal. So there were two properties in Delhi which were sold off in Connaught Place, Ashoka and what is now called Royal Plaza, which was Ashoka Srinivas.
Mm-hmm.
Now those two hotels provide, now they are doing a brisk business. They provide employment to other people. All the money that they make before that, they give the service tax to the government. If they will be making profit, then they will also be paying the corporate income tax. So the government role should be that, and unlocking the value, because changing the having a diffused ownership by disinvestment is not going to solve the problem, and government should not have any should not be in the business of running business, which unless it is critical for the country, for example, defense or something, some other things. There are critical businesses which for the country's security and safety they should have it. But otherwise, government should not only be not in the business, they should try and minimize the non-critical businesses which they can't sell. For example, a lot of things in Indian railways can be done by outsiders. but the government ends up doing things independently. I think the government should have a more narrower role in terms of providing safety, security to us, providing national safety, ensuring that our country is prosperous by having good infrastructure, running the hospitals and providing education. That should be good enough. Good enough many for them to manage, otherwise then try and fit it into everything where we have succeeded in demonstrating in the last 70 years that we can't do it well.
Like taking your point forward, Hindustan Zinc was actually a brilliant choice that government made by disinvesting. So sir, my question would be here, what are your views about the basic frauds that are coming up in the public sector banks? The recent will be the PNB scam, where we see actually the Gitanjali Gems brand being demolished and the PNB brand also taking a hit. So we see both the parties are taking a hit. If there could have been a negotiation between the parties, that could have been better for the entire economy. But on the other hand, we see these frauds are actually not the entire organization, but maybe the fault of 2 or 4 or 5 members of the bank. So what could be possible measures that the government or that the organizations and the public sector banks can take up to actually avoid these frauds?
It is just a matter of fixing accountability, tightening the process, making people accountable for commissions and omissions. And if that is not being done, and that can be done only if you are able to provide them, if you are able to provide these managements complete autonomy. If anybody can instruct a bank chairman on the phone to do something, then how can somebody come back and say that, why did you do it? To be able to hold you accountable for something, I should be able to give you freedom to operate. Okay. They don't have the freedom, they're government owned. Till we have government deciding on the appointments of chairmen and management of these people, then holding them accountable, making a transparent, accountable system. There are enough background work done in terms of how to make things, processes transparent and accountable. And I think government has initiated this step. This will take a long time. Public sector banks might be needed because there are things which public sector banks do which private sector banks will never do. But at the same time, the way they do it, it might not be worth doing it.
Correct.
So unless the government is able to fix the accountability of commissions and omissions and devise an incentive system, make them involved in a manner that they have a skin in the business. Unfortunately, public sector by its very design does not reward for excellence and does not penalize for blunders.
So one last question would be that during the discussion we saw that you were against cryptocurrencies, but you were
not against. I think it should not be a currency.
Just advise us not to go on.
Not
just.
Yeah. But you were for technology and you...
The blockchain technology is magical.
Yeah, so you put significance on the technology and you say that we can adopt that in the financial sector.
Yeah, it will have great usage in the financial sector.
So what are your views on the recent digitization of the payments channel and the recent launch of India Post Payments Bank? How can that play a role in growing our economy?
I would also like to add this question. The incoming various technology like UPI, the various payment banks, e-wallets, how does this actually affect the economy and how this digitalization could actually make India grow as a financial country?
It helps a lot. It accelerates the economy. If you have 100 rupees and it used to take 15 years before for that 100 rupee to reach your village so that somebody in the village can spend that money. So the money is not at work for the next 15 days.
Right.
When you are able to transfer that money, so the money is with you, which can be consumed, or that money is with somebody which can be consumed 1 hour later. So the velocity of money improving, you have more money at work.
Mm-hmm.
There was more money in transit before. Now there is more money at work. So accelerated movement of ability to move money quickly is a very important goal, and it also reduces your vulnerability of depending on unscrupulous money lenders and other people, because when you are cornered, then you go and borrow at high rates and then you get into a infinite loop of indebtedness. So this enhances velocity of money, which is a good thing. It accelerates the economy.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you
for giving your time to us. It was was a pleasure hosting you and getting your insights on the topic.
Thank you all for your hospitality. Thanks.